a year ago, or just over a year ago, at my iClinic, we made the decision that SMILE, the VisionMax SMILE from Zeiss, was a revolution. When I first saw the SMILE technique, I just had this instant feeling of, this is a true breakthrough. I have to have this machine. So we made the decision to invest in the suite, which consisted of the VisionMax, the femtosecond laser, and the MEL 90, which is the excimer laser that goes with it, although you don't need the excimer to do SMILE. And we began this journey of learning, because up to then I was really an intraocular man. All my refractive surgery was intraocular, faking implants, refractive lens exchanges, and so on. So moving to the cornea was quite a learning exposition for me and my colleagues. So here we are, just over a year later, and I want to sort of show you what we managed to do and why, even more than ever, we believe that the technology of what is essentially robotic laser refractive surgery is a major breakthrough. And it also links up with the other things that are changing in myopia, whereby people are beginning to see a small chink that may allow us to modulate the progression of myopia in young people, and what that might affect, how that might affect their attitude to laser refractive surgery later on in their life. Are we going? Not yet? 4 minutes, okay. So, surprisingly, one of the biggest decisions we had to make when we decided to buy the laser was the main door big enough to get the machine in the room? Literally by half a centimeter, otherwise we would have to take the door off the door jamb to get the machine in. So they brought the machine, they assembled it. It was quite exciting to see this van arrive from Germany, German plates on, and a hydraulic lift on the back. And when they pulled open the door, there's this shrink-wrapped, bubble-wrapped VisionMax laser. And you think, wow, this is quite intriguing. We may as well just go back to the off my laptop, even though it's a little bit funny on the screen. Okay, so we are dependent on slides, keynote, PowerPoint, and so on. So to show you what where we've got to, and the parameters of that exit cut made on the side that you'll see shortly. The great advantage, of course, is that the nerves and the anterior stroma are left intact. The anterior stroma is the strongest part of the cornea. And of course, in LASIK, we have to cut everything because we have to lift the plaque up. But in SMILE, they're left intact, and also the corneal nerves largely are left intact, much more so than in LASIK. So there's two great advantages straight away. It leaves the cornea stronger and cuts fewer nerves, and that's why we see far less dry eye post-SMILE than we do post-LASIK. And it's also much briefer in its duration, so dry eye is a few weeks most following SMILE. So if you just have a look at the machine itself, so this is the VisuMax, and you can see the patient lies on the table. There's a joystick there, which is the patient has moved, not the machine. So the patient lies on this operating table, and the patient has moved up to the machine, left, right, literally half a millimeter is in control, forwards, backwards, down, sideways, and so on, and docked onto the machine, onto a cup, which you'll see shortly. And this is the VisuMax. This does the SMILE, and no other laser is needed. So here is a patient just about to have the docking. The patient is lifted up so that the eye is kissed by that white cup, which is corneal, is curved, so it sits on the curve. You don't flatten the cornea. It's the shape of the curve. The shape of the cornea is left curved. And there's a gentle suction, a sort of gentle kiss, where the patient's eye is basically kissed by the cup to hold it in place. And there's a great advantage in this, which I'll show you shortly. So here, if I go back to, this is, this is the actual refractive procedure in total, right? The white ring is the reflection of the cup as I'm bringing the patient up with the joystick in my right hand. I get everything completely concentric, the patient staring at the flashing green light. Now there's the contact. Now the cup is actually touching the cornea. And we get the ring of contact exactly concentric with the flashing green light. So we know the procedure is going to be exactly on the optical axis. The patient's going to be looking exactly. There's the suction going on. You can see the eye is now held in position. The first cut, which is coming now, is the refractive cut. So this is deep in the cornea, maybe 250 microns or 200 microns into the cornea. Now the side cut around the edge, you see a ring appearing on the edge of this. And then the cap cut. So here's the cap cut on the surface of the top. And that is the entire refractive procedure. That is how the laser deals with delineating the lens. Down at 4 o'clock, you can see a white curved line. That is where the lenticule is extracted, which we'll see shortly. So this is what the eye looks like immediately afterwards. You can see how the laser now has shown up the lenticule. It's kind of revealed it, as it were, unmasked it. And then all that's necessary is surgically is to remove it. So up to now, everything has been done totally robotically. If you can press a foot pedal, you can do it up to now. And in fact, some of you may have been to some of our CET evenings where you optometrists get to do the procedure on pig's eyes. And if you haven't, please get in touch with us, because we've got a few more of those evenings planned, so you can come and actually do the procedure yourselves on a pig's eye, not on a patient. So now the next video, I think, is one of the most beautiful things in all of surgery. It is removing the lenticule. Eventually. Okay, we have to go back. Yep. Now in with the forceps, here it is. You see? See how it comes out through that small incision? And this is a -6 correction. And when you look at that, that's about 0.1 of a gram of tissue. And that's all it is that makes you -6. expensive. And that's the whole procedure. And it really is quite, I think it's when I remove that lenticule, it's almost like a ballet, rather than a surgical procedure. This is a patient, that's not the same patient, as a separate patient. This is first day post-op, and that's what the cornea would look like the first day. This is one of the, I think this might actually have been our very first patient, and I remember thinking, wow, that is amazing. And if you think that's impressive, this is the same eye. This is her same eye pre-op. So you can see there's really no difference at all. About a week later, if you look closely, you can see a line just at about 300 microns into the cornea, which is the lenticule interface. I don't know if you can just make out. You can see epithelium, and then you can see Bowman's membrane. And then underneath Bowman's membrane, there's another white line, which is the interface between where the two sides of the lenticule had been. And within another few weeks, that's completely disappeared as well. There's really nothing to see within a few weeks' time. And, you know, next day, they frequently will be 0-1, 0.1, certainly from the plan of 0.00, right down to the chart, at the bottom of the chart, day one. And then that improves even further as the remodeling occurs of the epithelium and so on. So here's a typical post-op case. This is a wavefront analysis. If you look at the lower one, the lower right, lower left, the sort of bluish, represents how well the light's focused. If you're not familiar with wavefront analysis, that's a pretty good result. Yet the green figures up at the top is the actual wavefront refraction, which is about the spherical equivalent of about less than half. Which, you know, is a pretty good result for any level of refractive surgery. And this was our usual sort of final. So, just looking at SMILE, so far, because we're quite novice, a year is not a long time in refractive surgery. So far, we've had no loss of best acuity, so everybody, 6.5 or better, unaided. In each eye, we've had no complications, infection, loss of flaps, loss of lenticules, and so on. We've had some have been, one or two have had it. One patient in particular had a slight delay. They had a loose epithelium which came off just at the end of the surgery, but within 5 or 6 days it then reattached. And we've had no significant dry eye symptoms. They do get dry eye from short period. They do use lubricants very quickly. They're out of lubricants. You kind of have to remind them to put the lubricant drops in because they're so short back in the lecture. So we're very pleased with our initial results with SMILE, and it really is a completely different approach and a completely different solution to the problem of myopia and its burden on people and on in cataract, I'm used to patients saying, a typical scenario might be a patient who's all their life been myope with a bit of a sill, minus four with the two sills, and they come and have cataract surgery, put in a toric implant, and they get a plan, and they come back and they're just ecstatic. I hope you've seen these patients of mine or of other surgeons in your clinics. And they will say, even as a child, I did not have vision as good as this. And then when you see that in cataract, and then you can offer it to people who don't have cataract, because that's the other thing they will often say, I wish I could have had this when I was younger. My life would have taken a different path. So patients are burdened by myopia, and they are relieved of it, and it's like sort of getting out of a wheelchair when they are no longer So we are, as I say, I'm more enthusiastic now after the first year than I was even at the beginning. So that was SMILE. The other technology that the Zeiss Visiomax and the Zimmer, the Bell 90 laser, is presbyond. which is an approach to presbyopia that is also very intriguing. I was very skeptical of this. I personally don't really enjoy monovision, but this is not monovision. It is a blend of vision between the two eyes. I've been very impressed at how successful it has been for patients who've chosen to have presbyond. So what is presbyond? Presbyond is different. It is a LASIK-based procedure. We are lifting a flap. We are using flap technology to expose the stromal bed so that we can carry this laser-blended procedure. And the reason we need to lift the flap is because we need to use the excimer laser to do the ablation. With SMILE, we don't ablate the lenticule, we actually define it and remove it. In LASIK, you expose the lenticule and burn it away with the excimer laser. But the one advantage that excimer still has over over SMILE is that we can induce a specific amount of spherical aberration. And it's been discovered that Dan Reinstein at the London Vision Center and others have discovered that a certain amount of spherical aberration is very advantageous, that it allows the brain to decipher the image without detecting any blur. Now, previously, we thought all aberrations are bad, and we did this, we had this sort of supervision era when fighter pilots were told that, you know, perfect vision without any aberrations, but those patients told us that they actually didn't like that vision, that we discovered that they needed some aberration, some level of aberration. Obviously too much is too bad, but the right amount is the right amount. And what we use in this technology is we induce a certain degree of aberration deliberately in each cornea to give a blend of near, intermediate, and distance vision, which the brain then, its algorithms take on and make into one continuous focus. Sounds crazy, and it is crazy, but I can tell you, it works. I'm really intrigued when patients come back for a 3 or 4 6 month checkup, how totally independent they are of glasses, and how totally no problem driving at night, no halos, all that sort of thing. And it doesn't make sense, but it does work. So we now no longer offer multifocal implants at My-iClinic. Sometimes we have a patient saying, oh, do you do the Symphony lens or whatever? And we explain, no, we don't, because we have something that's better. So we actually have stopped implanting multifocal implants. And I'll show you a patient shortly which illustrates the advantages of presbyond over, say, a multifocal implant. So the flap, for presbyond, we still use the vision rays to cut the flap. But we just cut the flap, and you'll see how the flap differs from the. This is a flap being cut. And you remember the SMILE was basically four cuts. This is basically two cuts. Sorry to between the two screens. Here comes the contact, and we get it exactly in the right position. Now, the centration for the flap doesn't really matter, surprisingly. And you'll see why in a minute. And then you'll see the suction come on. Holding the eye with a kiss in position. So it's exactly in the correct way. Well, I'm happy that it's in the correct position. And here I'm moving the patient with the joystick. You can see how precise the joystick is. We're moving the eye literally half a millimeter with a signal movement of the motor. So here comes the flap. Now, you see, it's much bigger because we're covering a much bigger area. See the hinge at the top. There's the rim, and you can see there's no rim at the top, at the bottom of the screen, which is different, because that's where the hinge is. So that is now, the flap has been cut, usually about 110 microns into the cornea, but it's still attached at the 12 o'clock position. That's then dissected off. The patient is lying on the table, and the table swivels, we push the table around, so the patient is now lying on the second laser at the other end, which is the Bell 90, which is a sort of classic eczema laser. And here is the laser being applied. Now, what you notice is the eye is free to move. So this is where an eczema laser needs a tracker, because if the eye moves, the treatment will be in the wrong place. So the machine is tracking the position of the eye, and as long as it's happy with its position, it will deliver the laser. This patient had a lot of astigmatism, so you see most of the treatment is in the horizontal position. So there, now we've removed that lenticule, but instead of dissecting it, we have ablated it into a plasma, which is then washed away in the vacuum. The flap is then repositioned. A good wash, make sure there's no debris underneath, which is not so much a problem with the smile. These patients can see straight away. They sit up and say, "Wow." So this patient had a lot of SIF, and you know, straight away she could see that. So in presbyond, we always warn the patient that there are three phases. There's the immediate phase, the flap has to heal. That's about 24 hours. And then there's remodeling of the epithelium, and that's where the spherical aberration comes in. We know that the corneal epithelium is a very sophisticated. It's not just a covering, it's not just four or five cells. It actually modulates its thickness depending on the contour. And it's that modulation that induces, this part of the inducement of the spherical aberration. And that takes a few weeks to happen. And of course, the brain needs to learn the new vision, because this is basically near to medium distance with the spherical aberration. And it's not something the patient would be used to, but they very quickly adapt to it. Some days their ear is better than another. Sometimes the distance better. Over a period of weeks, it settles down, and they do develop true independence of glasses from near to medium distance. And as I say, they can read up close for long periods of time. They can drive at night with their halos and so on. Many of them still have glasses, maybe if they do a detailed, very demanding tasks. But for most of their day, they're not using any glasses at all. So here's a particular patient that I think links what we've been talking about, in that you can see this, if you look, I was expecting a bigger screen, but if you look at the refraction at the top right, the green left, this patient is +7 with a 4.5 SIL, and you can see the SIL there on the bow tie of the cornea. She had become intolerant, that's her right eye. That's her left. And she'd been a contact lens wearer. She was in her early, mid to late 50s. You can see she had a very high angle kappa. In other words, she was not looking through a visual axis. Visual axis was quite different to her pupil center and to her corneal vertex. So something like a multifocal toric implant was no way going to solve her problem, because it wasn't going to sit in the visual axis. The toricity might be there, the pupil might be here, and the axis is here. So a multifocal toric implant was not going to give her the vision she was going to desire. She had, the other eye was very similar. She had what I call a wonky eye. Everything was misaligned. And she was now intolerant of contacts. And her life was a misery, because look at that refraction. She was dependent on glasses that were expensive, that need constant cleaning and so on, and if they shifted at all, their vision was crazy and so on. So she was looking for something different. And she had a normal cornea, so we knew we could offer her a laser correction at some point, but she was nowhere near the laser criteria, +7 with a 4.5 SIL. The laser can't do that. She had a moderately shallow angle and a clear lens. So we came up with this plan. Okay, we do lens surgery. That will deal with her narrowish angle, which will progressively narrow over time. It wasn't essential, it wasn't the main reason. But it would allow us to move her refraction into a zone where the laser could be effective. So the plan was to do that, make sure it was a very small incision, because when you put the cup on, you don't want the cataract wound to give way. We decided on a monofocal aspheric IOL, not to try and which is a refraction of the implant. I said to her, look, the best we can offer you is that you are likely to achieve spectacular independence, but we can't guarantee. So she said, okay, let's go. So just to remind you what a scleral tunnel for 1.8 millimeter incision looks like, there's one. That's her having her lens surgery. And that's what the wound looks like. I don't know if you can see up the top there, the small scleral tunnel, so which you can imagine you can play around with this eye and that wound won't give way. So 3 to 4 months later, this was her refraction. You can see the sphere is gone, but the cell is still there. And she's obviously not seeing optimally, but that was part of the plan. And the same with the left eye. So here's a patient who now basically just has a big cell. So again, we did the surgery on her. We did the laser surgery, the presbyond. That's her post-op right eye, the left eye, which is balanced for reading. And this is her left eye, which is balanced for distance. And everything settled down. She did develop PCO, which is the Yan laser capsulotomy, so she's had everything. But she now is spectacle independent from all sort of tasks. And for example, she said, I went on a cruise, which is quite a well-off one, obviously. I went on a cruise recently. She said, it was lovely to wake up in the morning and not have to wonder, will I wear contacts? Will I wear glasses? Will I just walk around in the gloom? It was just like my vision was there straight away. So this patient sort of represents where these technologies can converge and give a truly unique useful benefit to patients who, up to now, would have had significant difficulties in pursuing the contact. But now, new kid on the block, atrophy, myopia control, and so on. Where does this fit into laser refractive surgery? We seem to be getting some grip on this problem of myopia, the myopia epidemic. I mean, I know you're all familiar. The two main statistics mentioned about 90% of children in Singapore are myopic. 90%, 90% are myopic. And by 2050, they realize that 50% of the world's population, not of the developed world, of the world's population, will be myopic. So something is wrong. Something has changed. We're doing something that isn't. We're not supposed to be doing, and it's making us myopic. And as we get more myopia, we get more degeneration, and cataract, and glaucoma, and so on. So we're looking at patients who might have enjoyed normal vision, but because of myopia, they're going to have impaired vision later in life, and all the burden of myopia that comes with it. So can we do something? So what we're doing now at My-iClinic is we have a myopia control clinic aimed at children, obviously, and we're offering them atrophy drops. What about the contacts? The 2022 rule? Who knows what the 2022 rule is? Nobody? Oh, one, two. Right. The 2022 rule is something that's been devised in Singapore. It's for every 20 minutes of close work, the child should be looking at the horizon for 20 seconds. Not at the end of the room, but into the far, far distance for 20 seconds rather than 20 minutes of close work. And 2 hours minimum outdoors every day in daylight. So no matter what, they can read, they can take their iPad, but they should go outdoors into daylight for a minimum of 2 hours. And we also, there's emerging evidence that indoor lighting that mimics daylight is beneficial as well. And we also measure axial length, because it's the axial length that's progressive. We know that the reason these people are becoming myopic is it's axial myopia. We have children in their younger than 10 with an axial length greater than 27. And it's increasing. It's really quite terrible. So there's this evidence that it's possible. We don't sell this as a cure for myopia, that they're not going to need glasses when they grow up. But it does seem to retard the rate of axial length. And hopefully, as we get into this and start It's very easy. Children are very good ones. We can do these tests quite easily. They quite enjoy the measuring axial length. Initially, we had to measure ultrasonically. There's no way you could measure the child's axial length with an ultrasound. But when they're just looking at a target, click, it's good. And it's very interesting how it, when you do it progressively, how the axial length does change in these very young children. So this myopia epidemic must be addressed because we're gonna have blind people from myopia unless we do. But the other question I have is what does this mean for the future of myopia? That if we look at a 14-year-old minus 2 myope, wear contact lenses for the rest of their life when they can have a 27-second procedure? Or are they going to say, no, as soon as I'm stable, I'm going to get fixed, I'm going to get normal vision as soon as my unit is stable? Because when you talk to these, I don't know what they call them, they're not millennials, but whatever they call them, I can't imagine them being okay with wearing contacts for the rest of their lives, glasses. When there is an easy fix that is actually safer than contact lenses. So if you're a 16-year-old wearing soft lenses, you're more at risk of catastrophic visual loss from a lifetime of soft contact lens wear than catastrophic visual loss from the laser procedure going on. So what option are you going to choose? You get on Google, what are the risks? Okay, we're going to start saving. So I think that the culmination of all this technology is going to mean that the next generation of myopes are going to be pissed off if they can't get it fixed. And I think they will choose refractive surgery. At the moment, most people are happy with their glasses and their contacts because that's all they ever had. And there was an inevitability about myopia. It's like baldness, there's nothing you can do about it. It's there and you just suck it up as you want. Whereas now they have an option. Now they will have had friends and relatives who've had treatment and lost myopia. They are, and they will say, well, this is something I don't mind. And you can see the technology is completely different. And the SMILE will get better, it'll get even more precise, and you'll have new lasers coming in, and it'll be even easier to do it. And it'll be so like normal. It'll be normal to have laser surgery rather than normal to wear glasses. And of course, presbyond, really, when you meet presbyond patients, it really is quite. Tempting. I wear readers from time to time myself. I know five of active, currently operating ophthalmologists, all of whom have had presbyopia. I know no ophthalmologist who's had multiple lenses. So it's very tempting. So our lasers have had their first annual service. It's intriguing to look inside these things and see how much stuff is compressed inside them. Things that, bits and pieces that you have just no idea what they do. But some, obviously, these guys do. And we're looking forward to the next year. And of course, SMILE got a bad press when it came out first. There's no tracker. Because the eyes held the position. And there was a lot of people who thought it wasn't going to do what it was supposed to do. But I'm very gratified to see that many of the people who were not convinced, established refractive surgeons who were not convinced by SMILE are now offering SMILE themselves. They're now sort of realize, this works. This is a better technology than LASIK. LASIK is a perfectly good procedure. We believe SMILE is better. So approach to myopia is changing. We no longer see it as something you have to work with. And I think the young people particularly will find that the case as well. They won't be as willing to accept their lot as a myope that people of my generation and younger have to do. And it's now because refractive surgery, the days of the disasters in laser refractive surgery are gone. It's like the days of really bad cataract surgery. Okay, it's largely gone. There aren't those surgeons out there anymore. There aren't their machines out there. Cataract surgery is safe, predictable, and in most hands, perfectly the best option. And it's the same with laser. So all the myth of laser, I know someone who had laser and it all went wrong, that's all going to disappear. Lastly, so we're looking forward to the second year of SMILE at presbyond, and we'd love you to come and see us at our CET evenings, and maybe even try doing a wet lab with us. One of your colleagues had a very when she pulled out the lenticule, she said, "Is that it? Why would anybody be afraid to have that done?" And it's very true. We'd love you to come and visit us and come and do some of our CET and wet labs. And if not, if you can't make it, come and see us on